break up.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Anytime you deal with technology, amen, there may be a few glitches, but God heard the prayer. The part that we may not have heard, God is still touching us. And we welcome all of you. Amen. Those who are now joining us with Facebook Live. Amen. We just thank God for a backup. So if Zoom have problems, we got Facebook, and we just gonna go on and on and on and on. At this time, our choir is going to come.
We need a mic.
Amen. As we go forward.
Keep talking.
Amen. Amen.
Keep talking. Keep talking.
They're telling me to keep talking. I don't know if I have that much to say.
Need a mic for Marilla. Somebody,
amen.
Somebody give her a mic.
Are we getting there? Amen. You all bear with us. Amen. Bear with us. Well, they tell me to keep talking. I guess I could. I said I wasn't going to sing today, but. Praise God.
Amen.
Come on, boy. preaching time. Amen. We're in the midst of a glorious time. I understand why many folks say, when we gonna get back? Amen. Because they just want to get a little taste of how it feels in here. Amen. But you got to experience that at home. You can feel the same thing right where you are. Amen. One day the Lord will bring us back together. But he's going to bring us back together safely. Amen. Let us bow our heads. Father God, again, we just thank you for all the many blessings you bestowed upon us. As we now prepare to bring your word, we ask that you would touch me, that I would be a vessel, that I would be able to deliver your word, what you would have for your people to hear this day. Father God, open up their ears and their hearts that they may receive your word. We ask for the continued presence of the Holy Spirit, that the Holy Spirit will continue to be in this place. Thank you for what we all have heard and what we've seen here this day. Continue to be with us now and forever. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, let's put our hands together. Amen. And praise to God for all that God has done for us. Amen. Again, we have no control over technology, but I think our team is doing a great job. Give them a big hand. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Reverend Burks. I know that in the midst of prayer and things kind of go off, it may kind of throw you off, but if nothing ever throws God off, amen, God is still with us. Today's message is coming from Luke chapter 3, verses 7 through 18. Those who are able to stand, a little lengthy reading, but we ask that if you're able to stand in honor of God's word, you would today. Luke chapter 3, verses 7 through 18. We shall be reading from the New International Version. Luke 3, verses 7 through 18. John said to the crowds coming out to be baptized by him, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance. Do not begin to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' For I tell you that out of these stones God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. What should we do then?" the crowd asked. John answered the man with two tunics, "Should share with him who has none, and the one who has food should do the same." Tax collectors also came to be baptized. "Teacher," they asked, "what should we do?" "Don't collect any more than you are required to," he told them. Then some soldiers asked him, "And what should we do?" He replied, "Don't extort money. Don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay." The people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Christ. John answered them all, "I baptize you with water. One more powerful than I will come, thongs of whose sandal I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather wheat into his barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire." And with many other words, John exhorted the people and preached the good news to them. Our message today is entitled Preparing for Christ's Arrival. Preparing for Christ's arrival. And I do solicit your prayers today. Preparing for Christ's arrival. Whenever we are expecting guests at our homes, we start early preparing for their arrival.
Yes, sir.
We clean, we straighten the house, cook the food that we will serve, and have everything ready to show them that real Southern hospitality. In like manner, if we are to prepare for life, it is important to build a solid foundation in the 3 hours that we call reading, writing, and I know the word is correct, but arithmetic. While it is necessary to prepare for the arrival of guests, or just to prepare for life in general, I submit to you that it's more important for us to prepare for Christ coming. There is no better person to prepare us for Christ than John the Baptist. After all, he had been sent from God to prepare the people of Israel for the coming of the Messiah. He now pushes us this morning also to prepare for Christ. John launched the most pivotal point of human history, the coming of Christ. Now there are some who may dispute that the coming of Christ is the most significant event in history. But scripture proclaims that God someday will reveal this fact to all. When Jesus came to earth, humanity saw the Son of God. 1 John 1:1-3 says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. The life appeared, we have seen it and testify to it. And we proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and his Son, Jesus Christ. All right. I submit to you this morning that Jesus' impact upon the earth can never be overstated. He changed the world so much that men measure their years by him. Luke points to the fact that Christ came by dating the coming of Christ with significant events and historical rulers. The very first event was God's call of John. Therefore, the beginning of the greatest period in all history began with the call of John, the forerunner of the Lord. John was a man who cried out apocalyptically. John warned the people, and he quoted Isaiah 40:3-5 as his authority. He took the points Isaiah had made and proclaimed them to the people. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make his paths straight. Prepare, for the humble shall be exalted. Every valley shall be filled. Prepare, for the proud shall be abased.
Yes, sir.
Every mountain and hill shall be brought low. Prepare, for the crooked shall be straightened. Prepare, for the rough ways shall be made smooth. Prepare, for God's salvation shall be seen by all flesh. Not only the Jews, but all peoples shall see the Messiah. John's preaching was a plain and simple message, yet it aroused thousands. It woke them up and stirred them to prepare and look for the Messiah. If we want to take this text seriously, during this Advent season, we need to realize that we are not just preparing to celebrate the birth of Christ.
as important as God's incarnation is to the faith of the Christian church, John's message is not about a baby born in Bethlehem and just laid in a manger. His message is about opening our hearts, opening our minds to the fact that in the person of Jesus the Christ, God has come among us and he invites us to become members of his kingdom. It was an awesome message that John proclaimed, a message that states that God is acting to redeem us from sin and to restore us to a new life in relationship with him. So John's message should stir us up as well as prepare us for the coming of the Christ. First, by his birth, and secondly, as we await for him to return as judge. Now, the first thing that John encourages us to do in preparing for Christ is to show remorse over sin. Remorse, or sincere sadness, was something lacking in many of the spiritual leaders of John's day. Many of them came out to be baptized by John, but John said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath?" John knew that the Pharisees and Sadducees were not coming to be baptized because they were sorry for their sins. He knew that they wanted to be baptized because that was the thing to do if you were a religious person. And you know, today a lot of people would do anything to just keep up with appearances. We call it keeping up with the Joneses. These leaders did not seriously think that they really needed baptism. After all, they were Abraham's children. Are y'all going to help me? That meant to them that because they were God's chosen people, they automatically had a free ticket to go to heaven. Often we come to church, we come to worship with that very same attitude. Some show up at church not because they want to hear God's word, but out of a sense of obligation to family. Others come because it's just a tradition to get up and come to church on Sunday morning. And in the process, we trick ourselves into believing that heaven is ours simply because we show up here on Sunday morning. We believe heaven is ours because we pay our tithes and our offering. If that is the case for us, John has some strong words for us as well. You brood of vipers, you outwardly live the life of a believer, yet you do not believe. Well, what does it mean to show remorse over sin? It does not mean to be sad that others are offended by our sins, or just sad because we got caught. You know, some folks just get sad because they got caught. Are y'all in here? That is what you would call regret, not remorse. To show remorse means to change our mind about sin. It means that we no longer view sin as something that's fun, something that's exciting, something that cannot be helped, and is not that harmful to anyone else other than ourselves. It means that we see sin for just what it is. Something that damages our relationship with God and also damages our relationship with others. You remember how God destroyed the world with a flood, all because of S-I-N. And sin will move God to destroy the world again. But this time it won't be water. But it'll be what? Fire. I got some help in here. It'll be fire next time. As we confess our sins, let us think on how we have grieved God with our actions, how we've grieved God with our words, how we've grieved God with our thoughts. Showing remorse over sin is only the first step in preparing for Christ's arrival. The next step is to do not just say we are sorry, but show it in the way that we rearrange our life so that we do not fall into that sin again. Step number two, rearrange your life so that you do not fall into that sin again. John is saying to the people, the axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not, verse 9, produce good fruit will be cut out, thrown into the fire. The people wanted to know how repentance would affect their lives. They wanted to know what would a changed life mean?
Yes, sir.
What kind of fruit should they bear? Mm-hmm. So they asked John in verse 10, what should we do? John mentioned clothing and food, the basic necessities of life. The average citizen was to love and care enough to share his material goods with those who were in need. When the tax collectors asked John that question, he told them they should not take more money than they had been appointed to take. When the soldiers wanted to know how to rearrange their lives, John told them, don't use your position to terrorize people and extort money from them. He encouraged them instead to be content with their pay. A soldier was to respect, to love people, to be truthful, to be honest, and also to be responsible. And perhaps today, you who hear me are asking the question, what should I do regarding the fruit of repentance? Oh, it's good to know about everybody else, but what should I do? I would suggest today that we simply need to do that which is right in the eyes of God. Just do the right thing. Somebody help me. Just do the right thing. John would say, if you're a used car salesman, don't withhold the truth. You know, I love the old nostalgic TV. And I don't know how many times every day on 106, I think it's TV Land, about 3:30, 4 o'clock, I turn it on. And I've seen him 1,000 times, Andy Griffith Show.
Yeah.
And one of my favorite Andy Griffith shows is about Barney, who had $300. Y'all have seen that one. He had $300. And he decided he was saving up. He had been going out, taking Thelma Lou out. I can't say how they did that. In the squad car. But now Barney decided that he was going to buy his own car. Y'all see it. I'll cut through it all. But he bought this car and paid $300. This little old lady came from Mount Pilot, came down to Mayberry and sold Marty a car. There's Buddy, Andy, Thelma Lou, Goma, Opie, and AB riding along in the car. But all of a sudden, you all know the story. Barney had bought that fool money, conned him into buying something that had been put together with sawdust to make it appear that it was something that it wasn't. So if you're a used car salesman, you know that's a bad car. You ought to just pull somebody aside and say, don't buy that one. That's a bad car. John was saying, if you say you're going to do something for someone, even your church, your word ought to be your mouth.
Amen.
Are y'all going to help me?
Amen.
If you say you're going to do something, then you ought to do it.
Amen.
It would also say, now when you go to work, punch in the clock. Don't you go hide somewhere. Oh, somebody going to throw at me. Don't go to work and then hide. You ought to do an honest day's work for an honest dollar. Somebody ought to help me in here. Yes, 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 yes. John would say, if you were born a man, oh, look out here. Then you ought to be a man.
Well.
If you were born a woman, then you ought to just be who you are.
Amen.
Quit getting all confused about who you think you are.
Well,
God made you. Hallelujah.
Yes, sir.
Just be who you are.
Yes, sir.
Saying that we're sorry for our sin, but refusing to rearrange our life to avoid that sin shows that we have not repented. John tells us that such people will have no part in Christ. Well, my mind is kind of at work with me. A few Sundays ago, Brother Stewart, you sang the song. I think it was on the fifth Sunday. And I think that song went something like this. I think you sang that. We need to clean up.
Yes.
You remember that?
Yes.
Yeah, y'all remember that.
Yes.
He said, and he wasn't just talking about himself. We all. We need to clean up.
Well,
what we messed up. Come on, y'all help me.
Come on,
we need to clean up what we
messed up.
What we messed up.
Yes.
All of us have messed up some stuff.
Yes, sir.
We need to clean it all up and start. We got to start all over again. That's why before we receive the Holy Eucharist, the Holy Communion, we look inwardly. We pray for forgiveness of sins in our lives. We're not only to acknowledge that we are sinners, but we have to plan on rearranging our life. Rearranging our life. Changing some things that exist in our life. When the people began to wonder whether or not he was the promised Messiah, John told them that he wasn't even worthy to untie the Messiah's sandals. John knew that he was unworthy to stand in the very presence of God. While none of us deserves to stand in God's presence, Jesus the Messiah came to save us from our sins, thereby making it possible for all of us to stand before God. You understand, when John encouraged us to produce fruits worthy of repentance, he was telling us to produce fruits that are worthy of forgiveness. Nothing that we ever do can ever really earn God's forgiveness. God does not forgive us because we are sorry of our sins, but God forgives us because his son Jesus came and died for us.
Yes, sir. You want it?
So seeking to arrange our life so that we don't fall into sin is simply a joyful response to God's forgiveness. Mm-hmm. My last point. If we are to prepare for the coming of Jesus, not only must we show remorse for sin, not only must we rearrange our life so that we do not fall into sin again, but we must rejoice at the forgiveness that Jesus has won for us. We must rejoice at the forgiveness that Jesus has won for us. While God wants us to feel sorry for the sins that we have committed, God does not want us to fall into a state of despair over all that mess that we've ever done. You know, some folks won't let you leave it behind. Some folks think you got to carry all that mess. God has already forgiven you of all that stuff. Why are you still trying to carry it along? God has already forgiven
you.
Forgiven us.
Thank you, Lord.
He wants us to know and believe.
Yes, sir.
He's already provided a solution for us.
Me.
Yes. We think that God can never forgive us for what we've done, and we believe he has not forgiven us.
Well,
then we are saying that Jesus really didn't do enough
mercy.
To win forgiveness for all people.
Right now.
Say that is to say God, to call God a liar. To take glory and honor away from Jesus Christ. Jesus has not only won forgiveness, but he's promised to give us the gift of the Holy Spirit. John said in verse 16 that while he baptized with water, y'all following me here, John was baptized with the Holy Spirit and with fire. This is not a reference to a baptism that was different from John. Paul tells us that just as there is one Lord in Ephesians 4 and 5, he says there is one baptism.
Mm-hmm.
John was referring to the day of Pentecost when Jesus would visibly pour out the Holy Spirit upon his apostles. The Bible promises us in Acts chapter 2, verses 38 and 39,
yes, sir.
That the same Holy Spirit
mm-hmm.
is poured out on all those who are baptized with water in the name of the Father,
yeah.
the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
And anyone who believes in Jesus can be certain that they have the gift of the Holy Spirit
mm-hmm.
because we can only make a confession if the Holy Spirit has already created faith in our hearts.
Right.
How then should we prepare for Christ? We do so by receiving the good news. We rejoice because Jesus is our Savior.
Yes, sir.
Well, John preached
mm-hmm.
the good news that through Jesus, all are made alive. This is the good news that the people came out to hear John proclaim.
Good news.
This is the good news
yes,
that we proclaim today. And yes, it is a message that calls upon us
yes, sir.
To be honest with ourselves.
Yes, sir.
It calls on us to take a good look and how we live our lives in the hope that one day we might repent of our sins so that we can embrace God's kingdom with integrity. You know, it is through Jesus that all my doubts and all my fears are settled. Yes. It's through Jesus that I have hope for a better tomorrow.
Yes, sir.
It is through Jesus that I know that while this world is not my home, I got another building not made by hands, but eternal in the heavens. Ain't God all right? It is through Jesus. All my tears are wiped away. You understand? Christ alone is the one through whom we can find ourselves. He is the one whom we may locate the intrinsic reality of our own being. Christ gives us a brand new beginning. Christ gives us a new start. Christ gives us strength and he gives us courage to face life just as it is. Christ brings the glow of God to our life. Through him, we can find fulfillment. Well, you may ask, preacher, what does it mean to experience fulfillment? It means receiving a life that is abundant, full and overflowing. It means receiving a power and a strength and a determination to conquer those things that are evil in my life. It is experiencing a sense of growth and a sense of becoming. It is finding meaning and purpose for my life. It means dedicating my life to his purposes in my community. It means communicating and demonstrating God's love to a broken and a fallen and a fragile world. It means recognizing who I am. I am a child of the King. I wonder today, are you a child of the King? So to prepare for the coming of Christ, John called for baptism. For the forgiveness of sin. That has not changed. The Bible still tells us in this Christian age, in Acts 2 and 38, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins. The Holy Spirit in God, all right, until we believe that Jesus, he is the Christ, till we believe he is the Son of the living God, till we confess our sins and repent of them and be baptized for the forgiveness of our sin. It does not matter what else we do, we will never be prepared for the coming of Jesus. But I hope, I really hope today, you'll get ready for his coming. Not just a baby born in a stable, but you'll get ready for the Son of God. Yes, he was born in another man's stable. Yeah, he ate from another man's table. Yes, he wore another man's robe. Yes, he carried another man's load. Yes, he died in another man's stead. Hung out on Calvary. I hope you're getting ready. I hope you're getting ready, not just for a baby, but for Jesus, what he did. Ain't God all right? Thank you. Thank you, Brother Terry. You set it up. You just can't talk about his birth without talking about the end of the story. Yes, he was born. But he also died. He came to die for us. He died out on a hill called Calvary. He died. Went down in a grave. Stayed in a grave. 3 long nights. Tell it all. Yes, he was born a baby, but he died. Somebody say he died. He died. Yes, he died. Yes, he died. You ought to get ready for it. You ought to get ready. Let him into your heart. You ought to get ready to come in, Jesus. Come in right now. Do you know him? Do you know him? Have you tried him? Ain't he all right? Say yes. Say yes. Say yes. I'm getting ready. I'm getting ready. For it's coming. One day, Bethlehem Baptist Church over there on Bethel Road. It's on Bethel now, but it was on Silver College Road. Are you glad he came? Are you glad he lived? Are you glad he died? Say yes! Say yes! Yes! Yes, he died. But he now lives. Oh, my time is up. Oh, I've been going a little overtime. My time is up. Yeah, you ought to get ready. You ought to get ready. Take the light off yourself. Put it on Jesus. Get ready to receive him. Get ready. Get ready. Get ready. Hallelujah. Come on, Father. Get ready. Door is open. Get ready. Thank you, John. I'm ready. I'm ready. I'm ready to receive him. Hallelujah. Are you ready? Thank you.
Amen. Let's get ready. By allowing him to continually, through his Holy Spirit, be a part of our lives each and every day. Making us better. Amen. We're not all there yet. Amen. Until the day we leave this world, we're still trying to get there. Aren't we?
Yes, sir.
Amen. Amen. That's why I say I've got to clean up what I messed up.
I've
got to start my life all over again. Well, we're about ready to get out of here, but let me remind you that on next Sunday, that will be our last Sunday before Christmas. We will have Christmas morning service via Zoom. There will be nobody here at the church, but we will be via Zoom. Our Christmas morning services will be on Christmas morning at 8 o'clock. And then we'll have watch meeting service on that Thursday at 11 o'clock. Pastor Reverend Burks will be bringing the message on watch meeting. Next Sunday, which is that last Sunday before Christmas, even though you're at home and may not be in the sanctuary, I think our colors are red and black. Red and black, amen. Next Sunday, red and black. If you come to church, red and black. If you're at home, red and black. Amen. We're just going to rejoice in the name of the Lord.
Yes, sir.
Let us bow for our closing prayer. Father God, just as you sent John the Baptist to prepare the way for Jesus, help each of us to clear the path in our hearts also to allow him to fully come in. Show us the distractions in our lives that block us from worship during this Advent season. Touch us, Father, in a special way that we will remain centered in our around our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Yes.
And everything that we do, we're centered in our walk, in our talk, in our actions.
Thank you, Lord.
As we go out in this world helping others, we're centered in him.
Mm-hmm.
And as we celebrate your coming, we look forward to that day when this life is over.
Mm-hmm.
We'll be able to see you face to face.
Face to face.
Lord, it's not a maybe, it's a reality. If the Lord delays his coming, one day you will call us home.
One day.
So, Father, right now we ask for forgiveness of sins.
Yeah.
We've done anything contrary to your word or your will. We count them already forgiven. And now we can leave all those burdens behind us and go forward with a clean slate.
Thank you, Lord.
Lord, we love you. We give you the praise. We give you the glory.
Yeah.
Bless us. Father God, we thank you for all this West Canyon Church family. We thank you for the ministers, our Pastor Emeritus Ford and Sister Ford. Bless them and bless each of us. And now may the grace of God, love and fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us now and forever, in the mighty name of Jesus. And all of God's people said, amen.
Amen,
amen, amen, amen. Thank you, thank you, thank you. It's now fellowship.